there to the slides, but also if you want have a question, something comes up while I'm talking, feel free to stop me, interrupt, ask something, and can you clarify that more? We can just have it like a conversation, talking back and forth with each other. Okay. All right, so this is an overview of what we're gonna talk about. And so we're gonna go a little bit more into each one of these points. So this is gonna be a general, very broad overview. The specifics will be with you and your doctor or whoever the patient is and their doctor regarding their specific case, but this is just general information. So this is so for tips for living in a new strange land. I usually tell patients this is gonna be a change, it's a new reality that you have to come to face, and everyone does it a little bit differently. But this presentation is to help educate, you know, it's important to educate yourself. Also a support system. A support system is very, very important. And people find that places like here, also people find that in their family, friends. So support system is very, very important. And also maintaining a sense of hope and courage as well. So what is metastatic breast cancer? Basically, that is any time the cancer has spread from the place of where it first developed, so that would be in the breast, to a different part of the body. So that could be the skin, it can be lymph nodes. Usually we're talking about lymph nodes that are outside of the axilla, the same place where the breast cancer was initially started, so to other organs. So that would also be referred to as advanced or stage 4. So partnering with your healthcare team. So again, something that's probably going to come up a couple of times in this presentation is communication. Communication is very, very important. You need a healthcare team that you trust, that you can feel like you are being respected, you're being listened to, someone who you feel that you can bring up questions or concerns that you have, and that you think that they are adequately addressing what your concerns are. So here, this again goes back to communication. Don't be afraid. Do not be afraid to ask questions. So there aren't any bad questions. There aren't any wrong questions. So you have to be comfortable with your healthcare team that you can ask questions. And to be able to have that communication with them, it's empowering for you as well. So sometimes it's hard to remember while you're at the in the appointment what those questions were. So when you go home, make a list of questions. If you know you have an appointment coming up and some questions come up or some family members bring up questions, oh, I don't really know the answer to that. Write those down and take that list with you. It's really a good idea to have someone else with you at your appointment. If you can, have someone else there, because just having an extra set of eyes and ears is also helpful. You can compare notes afterwards, or you can just listen while that person is taking notes for you. So sometimes you may want to have copies of your test results so that you can go home. Yes.
Question, do doctors care if you tape the visit?
So that is a very difficult question. Well, so it's not usually that personally that the doctor, some doctors personally don't like being taped, but it's for reasons because a lot of times the systems that we work for, they don't like for there to be recording, just because sometimes those things end up being can be a problem later, because no one really knows what's happening with that recording, how is it being misconstrued. It's a little bit difficult. So a lot of times in my experience, when we've been in a situation where patients have asked, is it okay if we record, they have set recommended against, or they say, well, you know, based off of our legal team or based off of the hospital, it is not, they recommend that we ask it not to be recorded. But having said that, they usually, you know, we'll say whoever needs to be here, if you want someone else to hear this information. You know, what I usually do is I want to know, well, is it, do you want to record it so that this information can be shared with other family members? it's usually how, what, you know, I ask, well, what the recording is for.
Right.
And in my experience, most people say, oh, it's because I want to be able to go back home and listen to it, and I want to know all, everything that was said.
Right.
And so, so even though I personally don't have a problem with it, I know that I do, many of the places I work, they've recommended against it. So I tell them, you know, I'm more than happy to speak on the phone with someone, or I'm more than happy to have you come back in with that family member, or like it's mentioning here, I give you copies of our test results, or give you copies of the visit, you know, those kind of things. So the recording is kind of a tricky one.
When I was at Sloan Kettering for my second opinion, she didn't want me to record. So, but I was with friends, and they took my phone and they recorded in their purse.
Mm-hmm.
Because why I recorded at that time, so I could re-listen, because you don't remember everything.
Mm-hmm.
And then so I could send it to family and friends, so I don't have to repeat it over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
That was it.
Yeah, and I do
times I listen to it again.
Yeah,
you know, it's for me. Because getting a list of, you know, your test results is not the same as getting an explanation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
yeah. So I think that touches on this. So another thing that you wanna discuss with them is any over-the-counter medications that you're taking, vitamins, even herbal supplements. So it's interesting because I've had quite a few patients tell me, and I'll ask them outright specifically, are you taking any alternative therapies, any complementary therapies, because I want to know. And then some people will kind of hesitate to give you that information sometimes, because, and then I'll ask them, well, why is it that you're pausing or you're a little bit hesitant, and they will tell me, well, I know you're going to already say don't do this, or this is not helpful, and things like that. So I tell them, well, you know, what I try to do is I want to know, what is it that the benefit that you hope to get from that therapy, and what the therapy is, because sometimes that we do have a few, not big, large scale studies, but we do have smaller studies that sometimes show that maybe some of the things may or may not interfere with some of our therapies, like St. John's Wort or something like that. And so I can tell them, well, this one I definitely know I would not want you to take, or this one definitely, because you have hormone positive cancer, I definitely would recommend against that. This one I don't know about because we just don't have enough information on it. And then I'll say, well, what's the benefit that you were looking for? And if they say it's because I'm having a lot of nausea, then we can talk about that. We can talk about nausea, we can talk about, well, what about acupuncture? You know, so I think it's good to bring these things up and not be afraid that they're going to say, because then there again, it comes back to communication with your healthcare team and feeling comfortable and feeling respected and feeling that you can trust them to let them know these things. And if you feel that maybe you're not able to bring those things up, then you have to find someone who you can bring up all those things with.
That's a really good point. Because a lot of people think, you know, Eastern and Western medicine,
mm-hmm.
and you're just going to frown upon it, and I want to keep doing it because it helps me, so I'm not going to tell you.
Mm-hmm.
But it's true. Like, just because it's herbal and natural doesn't mean it's not going to have an adverse effect. It's very
mm-hmm.
important for you to know that.
Exactly.
And also to do the alternatives to what could help instead of.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. In general terms about treatment for metastatic breast cancer and how it's different from, the goals are different from what you, the goals are different from early stage treatment. So these are some of the, a list of some of the goals. Really, we're looking to manage symptoms. We want to maintain your everyday functioning. We want you to be able to keep doing the things that are the most important to you. I had a patient who was a concert pianist. And so it's very, very important to her that she does not get neuropathy. she was okay with doing our therapy, she was okay with chemotherapy, she just did not want to get neuropathy, she wanted to maintain that part of her life. That was who she was. Without that, she felt like, well, that was where she had her enjoyment. So with her, we worked with that because early on we asked her, well, what things would you like to continue to be able to do? And she did keep doing concert as a concert pianist and teaching kids. So you want to make sure that they understand what's important to you and then how to adjust those therapies. Also to optimize quality of life and then also to hopefully extend life as well. So it's important to know what the cancer subtype is. So there's different combinations of the hormones, receptors, estrogen receptor, progesterone receptor, also HER2. You have any combination of that or triple negative where if the cancer doesn't express any of those receptors, then they go into the basket of triple negative. And that determines what treatment we would recommend as well. That's one of the things, main things we look at. And then how do I know if the treatment is working? So these are the questions you want to ask your doctor. How do I know the treatment is working? What should I expect short term, long term, over the next few days, months, weeks? How do I know which side effects to report? Here I would just say report everything, even if you don't know. I don't know if this is something that's important or not. Because you, like you said, you're not sure. So report it. And if the doctor says, oh, that is not as concerning as maybe A, B, and C, now you know it's important for you to ask them and not to just try to figure out and say, oh, I didn't say this because I didn't know it was important. And then how do I get relief from pain? Or you ask them, how would we address it, these side effects? If they say these are the main side effects, then say, well, how would we address those things? And then what support services are available to me and my family? A lot of times we don't necessarily always remember that the family may need some support services as well. So that's an important thing to ask. And then if there's any concerns with costs, then let them know that as well, because there may be services that they can provide for that. So this is just a general overview of the type of therapies that are offered, depending again on your specific type of cancer. It could involve chemotherapy, hormonal therapy, targeted therapy, clinical trials. It can involve either one of those or a combination of those things at different stages. And sometimes a local treatment may be recommended for reasons of if there's a pain that's somewhere or something that's bothering you, they may recommend some sort of local treatment such as surgery or radiation. So some treatment, some considerations that also go into our decision for treatment is severity of your symptoms, the location, extent of disease. We look at everyone, the whole person. We look at the whole person and we individualize our treatments based off of that. And sometimes that does involve getting genetic testing for BRCA. So these are some of the classes of drugs that we use. And it all depends on your goal and what symptoms and just specifically what the goals are at the time and your diagnosis.
Can you go back two slides for just 1 second?
Yeah.
Right
back. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
Do you have a question about this?
No, I just wanted to write down one of these subjects.
Oh.
Sorry.
So this talks about finding the right treatment again. So these are some of the questions that you can ask our doctor. That may be a good idea to have this discussion early on when they start talking about treatment. Are we going to have hormone treatments? Are you thinking about chemotherapy? Should I enroll in a clinical trial? Would that be a good option for me? Are you going to use single therapy, combination of the different therapies, frequency of treatment as well, and options? So there was a patient that we had that was a flight attendant, and she couldn't do a weekly therapy, but she can do a therapy. She also couldn't do infusion, so she could do oral therapy, or she can do every 3 weeks. So just letting them know, you know, we want to still give you, there are different treatment options, and depending on what's important to you, we can always talk about what we can do. So just make sure to let them know. It's a shared decision. So these are the different hormonal therapies. When we talk about hormonal therapies, these are some of the things that we look at: your hormonal status, your receptor status, your menopausal status, if you've had any past hormonal treatments, and what the side effects.
Can you go back
one? Sure. So did you have a question about these? I just kind of, these are the different class of hormonal therapies. And which one that your doctor would recommend and which order is really going to be specific?
Yeah. I have a question, and I can't think of the medication, mm-hmm. but it's on TV all the time.
Palbociclib?
What's the brand?
Ibrance?
Yeah. Does that fall into one of these?
So Ibrance is one of our, Ibrance is not on here. It's a cyclin, a CDK 4 and 6 inhibitor, but it does, we do use it in combination with one of these medications.
So Faslodex is that one?
So Faslodex is one that's on here, the Faslodex, the SERD. Mm-hmm. You raise your estrogen receptor. So that is in here. Tamoxifen, aromatase, aromacin, those are all on here, included on this list.
That would be an aromatase inhibitor, correct?
So aromatase inhibitor, yes.
Okay.
And so tamoxifen would be the SERMs. SERMs that like blocks the estrogen receptor. So those treatments may be used depending on.
So what's the difference between like letrozole and Ibrance? The shot.
So the letrozole and Ibrance, it can be used in combination. Letrozole can also be used by itself, but usually I think on the commercial, if you look up Ibrance, there's studies that were done showing the combination of those in women who, depending on your hormone status, depending on your symptoms and things like that, your doctor may recommend that therapy. I think Ibrance gets a lot of attention because of TV. On TV, there's the commercials and ads. And Ibrance, used in the right setting, we have had, you know, depending on the person, it's a breakthrough in drugs because we haven't had anything for a long time, and then we had that. But it has to be very selected for who is the right person to use it on and stuff. So Ibrance is a good drug, but there again, it has to be tailored to the right person and situation.
If your tumor pathologist shows that it's made out of estrogen, mm-hmm. then you don't want to take a SERM, mm-hmm. you want to take a SERD, right?
Yeah, a SERD, mm-hmm. So it depends, so all of this would be very, you know, you would have to sit down and go over your doctor exactly what order to do some of these in. And that would be like that has a whole, that's a whole conversation in and of itself, like going up during your visit, which one to use and when to use it. But yeah, these and what combination. So I kind of want to.
Is it ever like progesterone, the pathology of progesterone?
So progesterone is one of the hormone receptors that we look at. We look at estrogen receptor and progesterone receptor. And we treat estrogen ER positive, or we call it ER positive, PR positive. Those go into the hormone responsive cancer. So that's in that group. So we don't necessarily directly target the progesterone receptor. The progesterone receptor is very bound in with the estrogen receptor. So if they're ER positive, PR positive, we treat it with hormone therapy.
Which one?
So it depends. So it depends. You can treat it with a SERM. You can treat it with a SERM. Or you can treat it from it all, you know. Okay. It all kind of depends. And so target therapies. So this is the CDK4 and 6 inhibitors, the Ibrance is in this. And it blocks a specific pathway in the cell, so that causes the cancers to grow. The brakes were kind of taken off of some of the breast cancer cells, and they're just growing. These drugs work in different ways, but the one way that the palbociclib works is it puts the brakes back on that cancer cell growth. Kadcyla is another one that's included in here. So there's a lot of different drugs that we have, and it depends when we use them and how we use them. It's really specific.
Kadcyla was which one on the list?
So it's an antibody drug conjugate.
Antibody drug.
Mm-hmm. So yeah. It's a class, isn't it? Okay. So then also the other receptor on the cell that's important is the HER2 status of your cancer as well, because that determines what therapies we can offer if we offer HER2 target therapies. And then now we also, well, and clinical trials is also an important part of our practice as well. And sometimes it is appropriate, and so we can always talk about that too. Yes?
Sorry. I just wonder, with clinical trials, so like you're at Memorial, so do you do specific, like you do certain trials, then UM does their own trials? Or do you guys all tap into the same trials that are out there?
Yeah, so so the answer to that is yes to all of those, actually. So most of the trials are trials that are national and sometimes international trials, and so each center decides what trials are going to be important for their patient population or what they find that is going to be a good trial to offer to in their area. And so for example, if you say, oh, we see a lot of hormone positive patients, you know, so we should offer more of these therapies. If you're in a academic center where sometimes you see more hereditary breast cancers, and then if you're in the community you don't see that many, then you may focus more on those kind of trials. So some of the trials that we have here are some of the trials that they have at UM, and also some of the trials that they have over the country, because they're national trials. But UM and some of the other places also have some trials that were started by specific doctors that work there, and so they will be specific to those institutions. And also, at the end of this, they have where there's clinicaltrials.gov, where you can go in there and look up trial. You can search it yourself, and you can find if there's a trial for that you're interested in. And if we don't offer it, or it's not offered in the area, then sometimes you can contact these institutions, and they would actually have you participate in a trial there. So there's a lot of different approaches that you.
And when you go on a trial for cancer, mm-hmm. is there a placebo, or is everybody getting the drug, or does it depend on the trial?
It depends on the trial, because so it depends on the trial. Most trials don't have placebos. You either get standard of care, or you get standard of care versus whatever the new treatment or combination of treatment is. So you're always gonna be getting something, but it depends on the trial. And it depends on what they're actually testing.
Okay.
If you're getting just the standard of care, mm-hmm. do they let you know that?
Also depends on the trial, because some of them are called what they call double blind, so that you don't know, the doctor doesn't know, and the patient doesn't know. But some of them are open label, so you know exactly what you're getting. And then sometimes we can actually guess what you're getting based off of your side effects.
That's the thing I was going to ask you.
Yeah.
If you're getting adverse side effects, and if you're not getting improvement, then can you ask them to be put on the real thing?
So the way that the trials, so we always have the option of, you always have the option of leaving the trial, and we always have the option of taking you off the trial if it's getting worse or the side effects are really bad. But we usually, some trials are set up to let you switch over to the other arm if they have evidence that those people are getting benefit over there. And most trials are built that way. If they do interim analysis, and they see that if these people who are getting this study drug are having a really, really good response, then they have what is called crossover. And
they do that in a double-blind study?
So double-blind means you don't know, the patient don't know, but then somebody does know, like the person who's like doing the randomization. So they will then unblind the study, of course, because they have to let you know you're on this other arm and then cross you over. Like they make sure that they don't want anyone to miss out on potentially receiving a therapy that's helping. And so they built all these. these things into those studies. And those are the really good studies that that are, the national studies are really good about that, if I answered your question. Okay, so this just talks a little bit about clinical. So we kind of went through this, that they're very well controlled research studies. There's a lot of people looking at them. They're looking at the they're looking at how they're set up, because if there's a standard of care, they don't want you to get placebo, to get nothing, and if you're not getting, if there's a treatment that's already approved for what you have. So they make sure they look at all of those things. So if it is a placebo-based trial, it's because there is no standard of care for particularly what they're doing or looking at. And they will let you know if you are in a trial where there's potential for placebo. And so you can make the option, or make a decision if you want to do something.
What was the term for it? Either it's double blind or the other type?
So open label is, or some people call it unblinded.
Can I ask you something? If there's a drug that you researched and you liked and you wanted to be on it, do you have to go to that facility to do it? Or
for, you mean a drug that, like if you were,
if there's a trial and you researched it and you like it and you want to go to that facility, do you have to?
Oh, you mean if there,
can I get it at your facility, or do I have to get it?
Oh, okay. So if you're on a clinical trial and there's a drug that you're receiving on trial, can you then leave and go somewhere else and get that treatment? So because the way that clinical trials are set up, because they're all, it's for the analysis, you can't get then leave the trial and go get treatment off label, I guess.
You know what? Excuse me, ma'am. I know you're upset that I'm asking too many questions. I'll be quiet.
Okay. So we're actually almost through, I think. So this is the information I was talking about, clinicaltrials.gov. So that's where you can go and get my
I'm sorry.
So we'll talk about managing side effects. So this is another important thing to bring up with your physician. What are the side effects that I can expect to have with this therapy? Not all drugs cause hair loss. So you may discuss with them, is this drug going to cause hair loss? Should I expect nausea, vomiting, appetite change? So these are some of the questions that you can ask them. What are the side effects you could expect? So we're going to talk a little bit on this slide about palliative care. So sometimes when you hear, I'll just say what some patients have told me, when they hear the word palliative care, they think, oh, okay, so does that mean there's nothing else that you can do? That's the end of the road for me? And so that's not what the term of palliative care, or what palliative care physicians are for. Palliative care actually focuses on providing and supporting the patients, supporting you guys, but also supporting your family. So they actually do very, we do well with managing side effects, but they actually can dedicate sometimes whole hour just talking about how can we help you with your fatigue and your nausea and vomiting. And those things we also help with, but they can really just focus in on that, because they don't have to focus in on the treatment and the treatment side effects. And at the same time, palliative care can be, you can get palliative care at the same time that you're getting treatment, all of your treatments. You don't have to, so it says, can be delivered at the same time as anti-cancer therapy. So seeing a palliative care doctor is just another layer of support that you can utilize. It's just another part of your support system. Yes.
Palliative care, though, are there specific doctors that do that, or is that for hospice?
So that's the next part we're going to talk about. So there are specific palliative care. There are specific doctors that focus on just palliative care physicians. But those same doctors also can be involved in hospice. And hospice is a part of palliative care, but they're not one and the same. So hospice can be underneath that palliative care umbrella. So hospice usually comes in it's sometimes a transition from palliative care to hospice. Hospice is usually at those last, when you've had the last few months, okay, that year, and you want hospice to come on board and help at that point. So they're separate, but they can, hospice is under that umbrella. Okay. here, specific treatments. So if you have metastasis to the bones, the doctor may talk about specific treatments for what could be considered lytic lesions or metastasis to the bone. And these are some of the bone shifting agents. And the doctor may also ask you to be on calcium and vitamin D. So living with metastatic breast cancer. So some of the universal challenges are some people, these are just some things that some people have brought up that they feel, and you know, these feelings are not all the time, but they come and go. So some people worry about the future. What lies ahead? Am I going to still be able to do the things that I want to do? And therein also comes some of the concerns with the treatments, and that's why you have to talk to your physician about if you're really, really tired and you said, I really want to play with the grandkids, but I can't because this medication is making me really tired all the time. So that's something to let them know, because the purpose is to keep moving. You want to keep moving. You want to keep spending time with your family. You want to stay active. And then also mentioning any pain or discomfort that you may have, because we want to address that. There again, we want to keep you active and enjoying the things that you enjoy. Sometimes distress can come along with the diagnosis, and so that can impact a lot of different aspects of your life, emotional, spiritual. So these are some of the symptoms that you can have with that: anxiety, some sadness, depression as well. But it's very important to remember that, to try to find that support system, someone that you can talk to, that can surround yourself with people that help you to be optimistic, hopeful, to remain positive. But just because you have those negative feelings that come and go, it doesn't mean that you're not an optimistic person or you're not being positive. I mean, we are all human and normal, so we're gonna have these days that are good and these days that are bad, and that's part of the diagnosis. But also, it's important to realize, hey, I think I'm feeling this way. Maybe there's someone I can help me. Maybe my family, friends, or even if you want your doctor to have you see someone to like a therapist to talk to. Those things are all reasonable. The whole point is for your quality of life. And so this talks about expressing emotions, how expressing emotions versus repressing emotions. And expressing emotions can not just have an impact on your emotional and your spiritual, but your physical health. So you want to make sure that you address that. And this also talks about finding a comfortable way to express yourself. Some people do it through art, music, writing, different mind, body programs for stress relief as well. And so these are other things that are helpful. Exercising, nutrition, here again, support groups, connecting with others, processing your emotions. So this talks about different important documents. So this is for everyone. This is something that we talk about for everyone. When I was doing internal medicine, every single one of my patients, we talk about living will, advanced directives, and durable power of attorney. Does anybody want to talk more specifically about this? So they just give a direct, they just give, here they're saying living will, advanced directives, let your doctor know what kind of medical care you want if you cannot speak for yourself. Durable power of attorney is a person who will make health decisions for you if you're unable to make them. This person does not need to be an attorney. Financial power of attorney is a person who will take over your finances if you're not able to do it for yourself. DNR, or allow natural death, if you would not like your own measures to be taken in event of cardiac arrest. And a will just designates who will receive your money and belongings. So moving forward, this quote is, my life has not stopped because I have been diagnosed with metastatic breast cancer. I pace myself, yet I'm passionate about pursuing my dreams. I consider the cancer an aspect of my life as a chronic condition, a thorn in my side, but it will never define who I am. So these are some of the cancer support community resources, cancer support hotline, open to options, friendly speaking about cancer. There's another one, I don't see which one, but there's also Research Not Ribbons is one as well. That's like a local one, but it's grassroots, but it actually pros and cons to it. As a patients have told me they found that good support there. And a cancer experience registry. This helps you to share your voice, educate the medical community, and policymakers. This talks about that. And that's the website. And also, this is